It's not working. If you've never put two and two together, the rooster song from the animated Robin Hood movie is the hamster dance song. The hamster dance song is just the same thing, but sped up. Mind blown! So, I recorded a whole another episode of the ending of Albino Lullaby, but because I'm incompetent, apparently, although that's not really news to me, I managed to record it with OBS in the like overlapping a solid 25% of the screen, like a whole lower right quadrant. So I couldn't salvage that. No, not OBS. Yeah, OBS. I couldn't salvage that in Vegas Pro by cropping, because it would have been a ludicrously small part of the screen. You would have had like just half of the screen. I had to toss it, and I really didn't want to play that all over again right after I did it. I've gotten to the point where that weird thing happens where once you start playing games to make videos, it starts being work and stops being as fun. It's like when you're assigned to do reading when you were a kid versus reading something that you actually want to read. My solution is just to not play that again if I don't want to play it, because that's absurd. Entertainment should be something you do of your own volition. And instead, play something that I want to play. That is maybe a little bit outdated. I'm in RetroArch. It's going to be an emulator, for sure. Of a system only a mother could love, so to speak. Although really, I think even the Atari Jaguar's mother doesn't love it. I got my Atari Jaguar the same way I got my Sega Genesis, by mowing every lawn in America and saving my pennies until I could afford it. And I chose the Jaguar because I wanted a next generation machine, but I did not want to have to break the bank to buy it. I could never have afforded the price of the PlayStation 1 or N64. And my dad, who I love to pieces and really get along with in every other way, was just totally anti-video game. He was convinced that it rots your brain, that it's the biggest waste of time in the world, and he would just have no part of it. I can't find it. Oh. I'm splitting my brain between two things. So every video game system I ever had, I had to work for. Which I guess taught me some good lessons, too. And when I got my... got this thing, he said, if you're really stupid enough to buy this with no games, I'm not gonna let you rent games or anything. You know, you gotta buy the games too. So I did. I actually got the console and just hugged it and you know, had it in bed with me under my pillow, because I was fetishistically into video game hardware specifically at the time. I just loved the look of the different consoles. And the Jaguar, man, that was. I have a knack for picking the losing console. Every console I ever liked was always the loser, like the Genesis and the Saturn and the Jaguar. But there's a lot of interesting stuff to be found in the landfill of history. If you pick the diamonds out of that dung heap, you can polish them and have a grand old time. Jaguar is right on the edge. It had just enough really great, compelling games. You can't dismiss it the way you would with like the CDI, where it had like one good game. I think the Sorcerer's Apprentice was that one. Or the 3DO, where it had like two or three good games. This had a lot of good games. It had the best version of Doom for a console until the PlayStation 1 version. N64 was its own thing. It had Atari carts, which was straight up racing. The items were present but irrelevant. You really just had to enjoy kart racing, and it was not multiplayer, shockingly. Which kind of defeats the point of the whole thing. It was beautiful, though. Had a greatly improved version of Wolfenstein 3D, which was full screen, 60 frames per second, with better textures, better sprites, higher color textures, better sound effects and music. Tempest 2000, everybody knows. Super Burnout, a lot of people don't know about. That's like the best line-scrolling motorcycle racing game I've ever played. Rock solid, 60 FPS, smooth sprite scaling capabilities. There's a lot of videos on this that are praising it as an unexpected, out-of-nowhere gem for the Jaguar that really, really does not belong on this system. Rayman first came out on the Jaguar, which really shows off its 2D chops. It was originally going to be a Jaguar exclusive until it became clear the Jaguar was tanking hard and fast. So there's actually a lot of shockingly good games for the system. It's just there's no more than about 10 or 12 in total. Worms is one of them most people don't even know exists, because Worms was not released during the lifetime of the Jaguar. The story I heard is that Atari rejected it because it did not look 64-bit enough. Which sounds really stupid, and it is, until you realize every other console manufacturer was pulling the same brain-damaged baboozery at the time. Sony famously rejected a lot of Japanese games, did not import them because they were 2D. And they thought American consumers wanted something flashy. And that we weren't going to buy it if it didn't have good-looking 3D graphics. So we missed out on a lot of the PlayStation 1 and Saturn's best games because they were 2D. And Atari was doing the same thing at the time. They were just responding, I think, accurately to consumer demand. So I think it was our fault. We were just so novelty-hungry. The minute 3D became possible, we just didn't give a shit about 2D anymore, and 2D could go fuck off and die, anything 2D, no matter how lovely and fun. And Worms is a good-looking and fun game. If you compare this, if you go pull up screenshots of the Genesis version, there's a big, big difference. There's way more colors, it's way richer, there's more parallax scrolling layers. The only thing this lacks that the PC version had are the cutscenes, and you can't zoom in or out. Which is a shame, but really, you're not missing much other than that. I wouldn't say that it's the absolute best version of the PC game. That would be the PS1 or Saturn versions, which had everything intact. But really, for a cartridge-based console that was sort of in between generations, this is what the Jaguar was really good at, was ports of PC and Amiga titles from that era. It had exactly the right hardware for it. It was ideal for Doom, and anything below it. It had fantastic versions of a bunch of games that were on PC or Amiga, and it just did them beautifully, because it had, whereas the Genesis could display, as I recall, 64 colors on screen at any one time, which is nothing. No, I'm not going to use that. I need that for later. Fuck, I hit my own guy. The Genesis could display 64 colors on screen, which meant it was very washed out, and the gradients were very sort of, what's the word I want? Stratified. You could very clearly see if there was a transition from, for example, dark blue to light blue, you could very clearly see the lines. It was not smooth, whereas it's very smooth on Jaguar because it has enough colors to actually do all the intermediary shades of blue. Which doesn't matter to anybody now, but that was how we measured graphical fidelity back in the day. You know, back in the 2D days. Genesis version of Worms also had only one layer of water, rather than the five or so in this version. So Jaguar was a great machine for doing justice to games that had lackluster, crappy-looking ports on Genesis and Super Nintendo. It could just about do them perfectly. I'm surprised we never got a port of Rise of the Triad, because that's really right in the sweet spot of what the Jaguar was good at. It could just barely do Doom, and even then it was about 15 frames a second, which was smooth for Jaguar. It was really good at Star Fox type graphics, like untextured. Oh wow, you really fucked yourself there. Untextured polygons, which we saw in Iron Soldier, which ran very smoothly. Unlike Star Fox, it was full screen. It was not in a black border. It was 30 frames a second, and ran and looked pretty nice for that type of graphics, which makes it all together more confusing that Cybermorph, despite being also untextured polygons, ran like shit. I never really understood that. I think that the Iron Soldier developer just understood the hardware better. Iron Soldier 2 was even mostly texture mapped and still ran beautifully. So clearly it was possible to get that those kinds of visuals out of the machine. I can't put it all on developers, though, because as John Carmack once said, I believe that's where I heard it from, he said there was a mistake in how the system architecture was designed. There was like one little flaw that introduced a severe performance bottleneck when it came to specifically textured polygons. And if it hadn't been for that mistake, he said that we could have seen the Jaguar competing very credibly with early PlayStation 1 and Saturn titles. But even the machine we got is remarkably good at the things that at 2D and at some limited amount of 3D. Better than the 32X by far. The 32X really did not improve the Genesis as much as you would expect it to. It did 3D. It did untextured polygons reasonably well. It could only do 512 colors, whereas the Jaguar could do several thousand on screen at once. I think some weird number like 4096 out of a possible 16 million. Which is why Rayman looked as good as it did. The Jaguar even outperformed the Neo Geo at 2D, which is saying something. It could do larger sprites, it could do more of them, it could do more simultaneous distortion effects and background layers. It was a 2D beast. If you want to get a sense of where it actually was in terms of performance, only the system bus between all the processors was actually 64-bit. All the processors were either 32 or 16. The performance-wise, it was about on the same level as Game Boy Advance. If you ever saw some of the 3D games on the Game Boy Advance towards the end of its lifespan, like Asterix and Obelix XXL or Driver 3, that gives you a good sense of what we could have seen in the way of 3D texture mapped games from the Jaguar if it had survived a little bit longer. Oh, that worked out better than expected. Of course there's an ocean of blood. Why wouldn't there be? Try to get me from there, you motherfucker. I've still got hands, it's weird. The hands, but I can also use the gamepad, and there's a keyboard down here, in fact. I just don't have tracking down there. I also can't get rid of this tablet for some reason. I don't understand the controls of Big Screen since it updated. Can I hit him there? I think so. So because I worked so hard for the Jaguar, and even though I knew I made the wrong decision soon after buying it, I kind of became an apologist for it, which a lot of people do when they get stuck with something. And you want to convince yourself you didn't make a mistake, so I would defend it. I would be like, no, this isn't shit. This is actually a really good system. Look at its good games. And I sort of still... Stand by. I convinced myself. I drink my own Kool-Aid now. The Jaguar is not all that bad. It has some gems on it that are really worth playing. A lot of them, surprisingly, came out after the system died. I can't afford to miss. Oh, and I fucking missed with the homing missile. How did I do that? I'd also compare it to, like, when a mother appears in court and defends her son, even who she knows he killed whoever the victim was, but it's his mother. To your mother, you're always blameless. So he's like, oh no, he's a good boy, he didn't do any of this. While secretly knowing he fucking did. That's how it is with a Jaguar. It, you know, you grow to like it. When you're stuck with this and this is all you have, you grow to like it. And you see the good in it that other people don't see. That's why there's a lot of people who still develop for Jaguar in the modern day. I wish more people did because then we could get awesome homebrew games like Soleil for the Sega and Genesis and CD. And Dreamcast, surprisingly. If I could get an RPG like that on the Jaguar, my life would be complete. I often think what I would have done differently if there was any way to run Atari differently so the Jaguar would have succeeded. First thing I would have done is build the CD drive in because it's cheap enough. At $159, it's far short of the $400 price tag of like a PlayStation. You can still come in far enough under the price of the PlayStation or Saturn to undercut them by a meaningful degree, and it's just better to have CD from day one. Of course, don't make the design mistake. That's sort of hindsight is 2020 though. But if you know, we're wishing here, I would say don't make the same design mistake so that you unlock a little bit more of its potential graphical horsepower. What else? I would say focus on ports of PC shooters. Like Doom and Rise of the Triad and Wolfenstein 3D, it had Doom and Wolf 3D. It did not have Rise of the Triad. It should have. And there were a bunch of other first-person shooters that were within its wheelhouse. That it would have done a good job of making those look good. Oh, he blew me up, and he blew himself up too, didn't he? Once again, hoisted by his own petard, whatever a petard is. I want to say it would have been the Xbox before the Xbox, but it already kind of was. It was a American-made console with a lot of PC ports and with a controller that was comically oversized and that advertised itself as being much more powerful than its competitors, which it was for a time. There was a couple of titles that looked better on the 3DO, but by and large, it was not. They were pretty close in terms of performance. I think Atari's biggest problem is they always want to capitalize on their older games. Or at least for a long time they did, because people still associate them with Tempest and Defender and Breakout and Asteroids. You can only modernize those so many times, though, before people get tired. You have to make something new. And they do publish new games. They're a publisher. They don't want to get with the times. And a lot of that is, I think, that they didn't have a 16-bit console, so they didn't develop their franchises the way other companies did. Like, imagine if Nintendo never moved beyond Donkey Kong and kept making prettier versions of Donkey Kong instead of having developed it into Super Mario Brothers and all the other. Or if the new Zeldas were all just graphically nicer remakes of Zelda 1. Imagine that. That's kind of what Atari's been doing. They really have a storied history of underpaying employees and screwing employees out of paychecks or overtime and just being really sleazy. So it's hard to feel bad, even if you got attached to the company because of their games and hardware. It's hard to feel bad for what happened to them. If you ever saw the Atari 7800, it compares very favorably with the NES. It handled, in fact, it had a lot of multi-platforms in common with the NES. So if they had just made a 16-bit machine like they were going to, a 16-bit machine with 32-bit qualities, which was what the Panther was, and then made a real 64-bit console after that and evolved their they kind of tried in some ways like Pac-Land Pac-Land was a pretty good platformer for Lynx. And I think 7800. Which shows sort of a hint that they're moving in the direction of trying to make their own Mario. I don't know if that was the right answer or not, but it was the only glimmer of self-awareness I recall Atari ever showed. It's a real shame this didn't come out for the system while it was alive. I think it could have sold a bunch of units. This is sort of how you were able to get ports of the quality that you would see on the PlayStation and Saturn without having to spend PlayStation and Saturn money. That's what they kind of tried to be, is the budget next generation system. Same as the 32X, but without all that extra shit you had to buy. If they had just not been skeezes, and if they had designed the hardware a little bit more competently, and if they had not been so against having 2D games on their system, which eventually, you know, they let a lot of shitty 16-bit looking games on towards the end because I think they realized that they were on their last legs. But also, don't fucking advertise it as 64-bit, for God's sake. Why did they do that? Technically it is, but you know what? You're not going to endear yourself to the consumer by trying to win on a technicality. By fucking lying about performance and saying, well, technically it's 64-bit. Guess what? That's not fucking as good. You trick people into buying hardware with expectations that it's going to be able to do things that it can't do. They're going to be mad about it. It's going to create bad blood. I would have called it a hybrid 32 system, 32-bit, because that would have acknowledged that it was 32-bit, but the hybrid hints that it's got better performance than other 32-bit machines on the market, such as the 32X, and to some degree the 3DO. I also would have put dual analog thumbsticks on the controller, and that was feasible. The technology existed. It's just that it was expensive. It would have made the controllers more expensive. But if you had two thumbsticks, you could have had something like Geometry Wars, which is another timeless, endlessly replayable game, but it probably would have been Robotron branded, because that's one of Atari's properties, I believe. And you could have done shooters better. If you're not going to have thumbsticks, you could have at least... See, that's why I said put shoulder buttons on the controller to begin with, because then you can strafe. And you can circle strafe by using the shoulder buttons together with the D-pad. If you're not going to have thumbsticks, that's the next best thing. Can I get it in there? I feel like I'm going to regret this. Yep, I regretted it immediately. What are some other games this had? Like Pitfall, the Mayan Adventure, and Flashback. If you divorce it from the question of whether those games were actually good, those versions of the games were about the best you could possibly get. They had all the colors, it had all the frames of animation uncut. Jaguar was really sort of a deluxe port machine for better versions of 16-bit titles in many cases. That's not necessarily a bad thing. I like this old 2D better than I like 3D from that period. Because we'd gotten so good at 2D, we could do whatever we wanted. But 3D still looked janky and weird and empty. Shit. Oh, I've got a minigun. If I go here, someone's gonna kill me, but probably can't be avoided anyway. I remember taking this to school, and we had a free period. one of the other kids, there's a miscommunication. It was my turn to bring a system. The other kid either didn't understand that, didn't get the memo, or decided he was just going to bring a Super Nintendo and Mario Kart anyway. And I was like, how the fuck am I going to compete with Mario Kart? Everybody's just going to want to play that. And they did. It didn't matter that it was my turn. Everybody just wanted to play the better system. So regardless of the fact that, you know, there are good multiplayer games on the system I didn't get to play, I cried hot, bitter, salty tears. And yet I can't really hold it against them because it's the fucking Jaguar. Who wants to play that? I can't even... There we go. Why did I bounce off of the box? Oh, there we go. Okay. I'm gonna get under some cover. And the Jaguar was one of those systems where if you had a kid over to sleep at your house, he was like, what the fuck is this shit under your TV? What the fuck? Why don't you have a normal person system like a PlayStation or a Saturn or something? The N64 wasn't out that then. It was delayed until 96. So between 93 and 96, there was it was sort of open game for anybody else to try to fill that gap before Nintendo did. I don't need a homing missile for that. Yes. The other thing is, they were really lax on frame rate. There were a lot of games that could have been much better if they just had a faster frame rate, and it wasn't always the hardware's fault. Aliens vs. Predator is one of those games everybody's heard of, because it actually is pretty wicked. However, because of how they designed the game, thinking people would notice that they put a cool feature into it, they killed the frame rate. The feature was that it calculated where everything and all the monsters and everything were on the map all the time. So there, in real time, all the monsters were actually wandering around. Which sounds cool, but what difference does it make to the gameplay? Fucking none. And it cost it a playable frame rate. It could have been 30 frames per second, I think, because the engine was basically the same thing as Wolfenstein 3D, but with floor and ceiling textures. That was a questionable decision. I don't know if that's exactly the reason, but there was a lot of real-time stuff being processed in the background that made no difference, and you could have chopped it into a linear series of levels and gotten a much better frame rate out of it, and it would not have, in the least bit, made it less fun to actually fun to play. It would have made it less technically interesting, but that's quite a different thing. You can't forget when you're making a game that the purpose of it is to be fun, or if it's a horror game, to be scary, or you know, whatever else. Uh-oh. Oh no. I was hoping I could get them all in one airstrike. I kind of still can, but I'm going to have to get my own guy too. And that's my cat yowling in the background. She always picks when I'm recording to do this. I love you, cat. You can get away with anything with me. This is going to be the last one, I think. It actually helped me. Thank you for that. Oh, I just heard her go out the door. She waits to see if I will open the cat door for her, because I have done so in the past, which was a grave mistake, because it taught her that if she whines enough, I will do that. And I don't know why she wants me to. It's not like it's hard for her to do it herself. I guess she just likes being helped. And now, after I helped her once, I tried not helping her, and she sat there yowling for 10 fucking minutes until giving up and doing it herself. And then the next time she yelled for like 5 minutes, and then the next time she yelled for 3 minutes, and it continued to decrease as she gradually accepted that I wasn't going to help her by opening the cat door anymore. Until I made the mistake of absentmindedly opening the cat drawer, which reset the entire process. And once again, all of a sudden, she would sit there yowling for 10 minutes. Because she got the idea that she had broken my will, and I was going to open that door for her going forward in the future. So I love that cat, but she is a shitty little demon goblin whose dark heart is made out of hatred. Part of it's that I got a notoriously difficult breed without knowing it. She really is a sweetheart, though. No one else believes me. It's like that classic Warner Brothers cartoon with the singing frog, and it never sings in front of anybody except for the owner, so you can't make any money off of it. She's only sweet to me, and she's a horrible asshole to everybody else. So nobody believes she's really a sweet cat. Just one of her many charming character flaws. Yes! Take that, global warming. Which is a real thing that is happening, in case you were wondering if I'm retarded. Not that retarded. The other thing I was emulating on here was a Sega CD game earlier called Panic, which I don't know if you ever played. That's absolute fucking madness. It's absurd. It is absurd. I love it. Stuff like that convinces me the Sega CD was also not a bad system. It actually had more good games than the Jaguar. Sega, I think, lucked out on that. A lot of companies didn't realize Sega had lost their mind and was going to put out another add-on, so that you had a lot of publishers putting out really good games for the CD format. If you ignore altogether the FMV cancer, there are titles like The Misadventures of Flink and Soul Star, and just a lot of cool shit that took advantage of the extra chip that did scaling and rotation in the Sega CD, as well as its expanded capabilities for storing 2D art assets, as well as better music. It's just that we were novelty hungry, and we liked to see game consoles playing video, so a lot of people were buying the FMV titles for a short period of time until everybody realized, hey, this is shit, I'm not having fun. A lot of what's shitty about the game industry is our own fault for just buying shit based on what looks cool, what's impressive, technically. Developers don't invent those trends, they just adhere to them and fill the demand. Oh, there's a lot of wind. Can I hit this guy? Oh, no! Hit my own guy. No, don't get the box either. Being able to see my trajectory like in Bust a Move would be helpful here. What is that? That's a tombstone, and I think they're dog tags? Are they soldiers? Is there a worm military that I don't know about? I swear to fucking God, if it's that one little bit of pixels there, I'm gonna re so hard and so loud and so pure. Yes! That's got to have killed him. Yes! I want to see a massively multiplayer online version of this with like 1,000 teams playing in real time. Like, if you've seen games like Place, I believe it is, where you draw pixel art and other people can erase it or draw over it. I think it's technically possible to have a game like Worms with that number of players all at once. Yes! And that's the way the news goes. Taken out by a dude with one health. That's all for tonight. Next time, I think I'm going to play some Sega CD games. If you want to watch that, tune in. I'm not the boss of you. It's going to be pretty great, though. I'm going to try to get a friend in here eventually, because you can do multiplayer big screen and have another dude next to you talking along with you. I've seen a lot of Let's Player channels with two people, though, and usually there's one dominant guy, and the other guy just repeats what he said, like in a different tone of voice, and maybe puts his own little spin on it, slightly. Dan from Game Grumps kind of does that, not as much anymore. There's a guy who, I don't know his name, I'm not a big fan of Two Best Friends Play, or whatever it's called. One of them does that. One of them is definitely the sycophant. I'm not sure if I want that in my channel. I don't know if I could strike an equitable balance between two people, but it could be fun. It could be fun. I'll probably try it at some point. Oh, yeah, like and subscribe. Or die!